Sabina Sestigiani teaches Italian studies at Swinburne University of Technology in Melbourne, in Australia. Her research and teaching interests include comparative literature, continental philosophy, and Italian history and culture. Her publications include Writing, Colonization, Violence, Landscape, and the Act of Naming in Italian and Australian Literature and Migrant Life Trajectories. Italian Women in Australia in the 1970s and 80s in Lontane da Casa, co-authored with Simone Battiston. And today she's going to present about the role of factual record in imaginative work, Melania Mazzucco's Vita and W.G. Sebald's novels.
Perhaps I'd like to start by saying that this is a new project for me. It's a sort of a new interest that that germinates from a very personal story. I recently started research on my own family, and so I started researching a lot of archives and a lot of factual records that belong to my family. And reading these literatures like Melania Mazzucco and Sebald became sort of intertwined with my own history. And then a friend of mine who is present here today, Virginia, she lent me, and I wanted to recognize that, she lent me Melania Mazzucco's book, Vita, a few years ago. And since then, I became so much interested that I started thinking about it more seriously, and hence the presentation of today. Okay, so do I have a clicker? So I start, since I like to compare, I'm a comparatist, I suppose, so just one book wasn't enough. So I started with obviously the main novel that I'm interested in, which is Vita by Melania Mazzucco, but also the German writer Sebald, which we'll be looking at towards the end of the presentation. So Vita is a very famous now novel, has been studied a lot, discussed a lot. Is a multi-award book. And what does it talk about? So it talks about the traumatic migration of two children from southern Lazio, close to the border of Campania, to the United States, to New York. So it really is a book about this city. So what do we find in this book? There's obviously the problems that migration at the turn of the 20th century had to face, so problems of adaptation, of assimilation, the lack of knowledge of the language. And the two main characters of the book is the migration of two children. So what is interesting about this book is that there are many stories, there are many lives that are intertwined in the book, and there is a very strong meta-narrative component. So that means the author slash narrator is part of the book itself, and what it's some kind of there's a lot of hybridity in the novel. So it always oscillates between novel and an essay, and there are different historical times that coexist at the same time. Now the researchers, the scholars that have studied it, that looked at this book before me, they've noticed that there's always been little attention to the phenomenon of Italian migration to the U.S., especially in the period that is examined in the book, so between the 1870 and 1921, and then again in the post-war era. So I guess it's an important book because it does exactly that. So it kind of fills this void, this vacuum, it's perhaps a lot of people are familiar with Melania Mazzucco. It's important to say that she's Italian. She never left Italy, so she's writing about this book from a kind of interesting perspective. What she does, she reconnects the two sides of her family, the sides that remained in Italy, which is the side to where she belongs, and the side of her family that migrated to the U.S. and to New York in particular. So she does, as I said, because there is meta-narrative component in the book. She's always reflecting in her own role and the researches that she does, and I guess that's the component that was most appealing to me because of my personal story. Now, Melania Mazzucco, who those of you who are familiar with her, she has a little bit of a tradition of, it's some kind of her, how do you call it, her, almost her ethos, her, something that, a vocation to unearth is buried lives. And that's exactly what she's doing. But this time is part of her own family. So what she does, I find it quite intriguing, because she basically creates this literary memory of an historical event that has actually happened. So the book is based on historical events. It's almost like a historical novel. And what she does, she mixes oral memories, historical facts, and she weaves them into her own narrative. And it's really hard for the reader, and she's keen of not revealing too much what is true and what is invented, what is fiction. I like to always quote, solo ciò che viene raccontato è vero, and that's what her father used to tell her. And I think that's summarized pretty much what this book is about. So it is, since it is told, it is true. So she's trying to write this coherent whole that is made of these little bits and pieces that come from different background. What she does, she restores, she revitalizes, and she's trying to rebuild what is lost. So she's almost a restorer of some kind. So the meta-narrative is also very interesting because it is almost some kind of autobiography, even though we are all very aware that the narrator, Mazzucco, in the book is not necessarily the real person. So there is that distance. And because of all of these different perspective, historical perspective, but also authorial perspective, that this book is so interesting on many levels. And I also like what she does, that she reveals what she does, meaning the her hypothesis that she tests all the time. And yet, so she constructs fiction, but yet at the same time, she is pointing a finger, hey, don't trust me, I'm inventing here. This might not be true. So it's all very, very interesting. And it's quite dizzy as well. Now, what else was I going to say? Now, there are different, as I said, there are different characters. So the Vita, the title of the book is the author great aunt, and so she's a legendary figure, and that she slowly builds and brings to the fore. So she has some oral memories that she can relate to, but then she has to invent really most of the story that are presented to us. What else was I going to say? Oh, the war is also a very important component, and we'll see. I've got a few more slides about that. So there's more than one war. There's the First World War, and there is the Second World War. Especially the Second World War is has got a very important part in the book, because the son of Vita, the author's great aunt, will be sent to fight in the Second World War, and he will be sent to the same village, so Tufo di Minturno, where his mother is from and where the old Italian ancestor come from. So we also have the Captain Dye's perspective in the book, which makes it very, very interesting. Now, let me see, what else have I got here? So this is the translation in English. So they're a few years apart. And what I would like to say here, I start with basically, and I hope you'll excuse my lack of complete and cohesive argument here. There are a series of suggestions, really. But what I'd like to have here before I start looking into at examples of the factual records that we find in Vita, these are some concepts that I think they're very important to analyze what Mazzucco does in a book. So these German terms are the quotation from Walter Benjamin's, and so it's the distinction between what Benjamin called Erlebnis and Erfahrung. So Erlebnis is the souvenir, the memory, il ricordo, and it's almost like a relic of the past, something that doesn't really have an attachment to the to what created the souvenir, and it's something that is dead. It's a relic. The Erfahrung is something much more comprehensive, something that is like a continuous with the past, present, and future. So what Mazzucco does in this book, what she's trying to do with the narrative, she weaves back. What she's presented is like a souvenir. Sometimes it could be a photograph, it could be like an oral story, something that she has heard from a relative, from a father. And she weaves around that souvenir, and she creates the origin of that very souvenir. She creates the narrative. Sometimes it's fictitious, sometimes it's more strictly related to the historical facts. But she creates something that combines, that makes it much more meaningful than a simple souvenir. There's something which is simply extrapolated from the past and called something that doesn't speak to us that much anymore. And something interesting is that the souvenir is the triggering element of the narration that prompts the recounting of the origin of the souvenir, and that is the making of the story. That's what she does. Now, here I start. I'd like to look at some examples of what we find. What I found so fascinating about the factual records, and I divided them according to themes that are mostly, I suppose, chronological. If we look at the novel, so the arrival of the two migrants in New York. So these are some of the documents that Mazzucco mentions in the novel. Something that she, in a meta-narrative voice, she quotes and says, "That's what I used. That's what I found." And while she quotes them, she doubts that, you know, the story that she's weaving is actually faithful to what really happened. For example, the census of the New York City, the records of the Mormons, for example. There's also this photograph. There are not many photographs, but there are quite a few, many more than in other Mazzucco's novels. The reproduction of the symbol of the Mano Nera, which was a criminal organization that was quite present in the U.S. at the beginning of the 20th century, and news of the criminal deeds in American newspapers. Why is it that particular thing interesting? Because what she does, so she takes into account something true, something that really happened, and then she weaves and she says something like, this could be the letter, the blackmailing letter that her father Agnello could have received, and she basically writes it. So we are kind of, if you don't read carefully, you say, oh, that's what he actually received, she must have found it. No, that's the kind of tricks that she does all the time to the reader, which is part of the, I guess, of the charm of the fascination. She also says Agnello did not denounce a blackmail to the police. How does she know that? So I suppose if we keep rereading a few times, we realize that there's no trace of it in the newspapers. That's how she knows it. And then she goes, then we know that instead of paying Agnello, Vita's father decides to sell his business so that he doesn't have to pay for the records, for the bribes that they were, the blackmailing that they were asking. And she says, forse Vita senza saperlo fu la causa della rovina di suo padre. Why is she saying that? Because in the newspaper she found news of children, of shop owners that were harmed, that were kidnapped and subsequently harmed because the fathers wouldn't pay for the blackmails. This is just to give you an idea of the kind of factual records that we find in the book. Caso Vita is also quite interesting. So she founds in the Rivista di Emigrazione, she founds this case of this girl called Vita, and she assumes it's her Vita, but we don't know. And there's this beautiful description. So she takes the description, doesn't say very much about Vita, but it tells us in great detail the conditions of life, where she lived, the house where she lived, the neighbors, how many people lived with her, and she uses that and she incorporates in her writing, the narration, that becomes Vita's environment. Or also the St. Patrick's School Register, and she also, I guess, looked through them and found a girl called Vita. But is it her? Is it her Vita? Sometimes she disguised this. Sometimes she says it quite clearly. I'm not sure. We don't know. Now, these are descriptions of Vita. I like to talk about this, the first, which is a description of a photo of Vita. But it's not present in the book. So it's some kind of a... It's a fictional photography, as Roland Barthes would have called it. So we don't even know if this photo really existed, but she describes it, we believe her. And that's how she describes Vita, but we haven't seen it. Perhaps Mazzucco really has this photo, but she didn't want to show it to us because she wanted to leave the... She didn't want to, I suppose, to ruin our imagination or to leave us with the memory of this other photograph of Vita when she was a child, which was obviously quite captivating because of her really dark, sultry gaze. What else? Mariana Zicola, she was a descendant of some fellow companions of Diamante's trip to the US, and she further validates Vita's existence. She had met this woman. She has worked for her in a restaurant. She opened up a restaurant. And she describes Vita in quite interesting tone, and obviously Mazzucco reports all that. She also reports this page of a tourist guide of New York that talks about the restaurant that Vita had, and what kind of food that she cooked. This is the photo I was telling you about, but is it a true photo of Vita when she was 15? She appeared in the Progresso on the local newspaper because she went missing, so she escaped with a gangster, and her father was quite worried, so he was looking for her. So I've got many more. I had a bit of fun looking up all these factual records, and I hadn't realized how many there were, and how interesting, how beautiful it is to get lost in all this list of records. Another thing that is also quite interesting is the narration of a photo of Diamante as a water boy. Again, this is another example of fictional photograph. This photo is not reported in the book. So again, we don't know if it is true or not. We have to believe her, I suppose. But there is a true photo of Diamante, which appears in the tram travel card in the 1920s. And it's kind of interesting also a description of the connotati fisici di un ragazzo, of an Italian boy who could have been Diamante, but again, we're not sure, that were taken at a hospital in Denver when also Diamante had been hospitalized. I'm aware of time. I've got just a few minutes, so I have to skip through a few things. Now, with Sebald, okay, 2 minutes. Let's see what I can do. So there are very similar there are very similar problems, I suppose, or preoccupation with memory. Perhaps I should say something quite general about Sebald and leave it with that. That after he died in 2001, he became a very researched and studied German author. And why did I put it together with Mazzucco? Because I'm very interested in how memory, all his books are about many things. There are many topoi in his books that we could look at. A lot of research have been focusing on is Holocaust research and books on the recuperation of memory after trauma. But what is really interesting is like his dependency on archives, on how memory is stored. Why does it matter to look at archives? And it's interesting because is very much interested in all these traces that the past has left in those archives, and that's part of his fascination of his writing. I'm really sorry, I didn't time this very well. I had so many other things that I wanted to talk about, especially two novels. So Vertigo is perhaps his first novel and is most interesting just for his dependence on the on archives, and the other one is Austerlitz, which has a lot of similarities with Vita. It is completely fictitious, so it doesn't have this, component of veracity as Vita does, but it has a lot of similar, preoccupation with memory. Just a few things that I said, there is the component of the involuntary memory, which is very Proustian, I suppose, which is quite beautiful. But he will see and make a point, the author whose past has been submerged, so we'll recuperate it slowly. So after we recuperate this memory, it seems like the enigma is resolved. Now we will know who Austerlitz it really is, where it really comes from. But no, that is just a fleeting moment. He will need the archive again to find out more, because what the involuntary memory does is just like some scant memories and something that is not really sufficient to really find out about the lost past. Thank you.
PAOLA SICA, Diaspora, Narration, and the Rethinking of Literary Canons, Jhumpa Lahiri. PAOLA SICA is professor and chair of Italian and at Connecticut College. Her main research interests focus on 20th and 21st century Italian literature and culture in comparative context. Her publications include the books Futurist Women, Florence Feminism and the New Sciences, and Modernist Forms of Rejuvenation, Eugenio Montale and T.S. Eliot, and also numerous articles and translations. She is now working on a book-length manuscript on women's relocated fiction, and I guess that's where Jhumpa Lahiri comes into play. Yeah.
This study of a contemporary author like Jhumpa Lahiri in the context of a debate about diaspora, narrative forms, and their circulation opens up various queries. For example, why and how one should examine this author's work in relation to a nation and its literary canon. If one examines Lahiri's novels and short stories, it becomes apparent that her works do not lend themselves to unidirectional canonical classifications, in that they translate different types of cultural memory and are written in different languages, although English remains the dominant idiom. In addition, the author's life experience is not limited to the boundaries of a single culture and language. Lahiri learned Bengali from her parents, but she received her primary education in English in the United States, where her parents settled shortly after her birth in London in 1967. While in the United States, Lahiri maintained regular contacts with some relatives in Calcutta. She also broadened her range of languages, including Latin and Italian. She visited Italy for the first time in 1994 when she was 27, and she returned to that country other times while maintaining the United States as a base. Lahiri won immediate success with her creative works written in English, many of which focus on life scenes of South Asian people who migrated to America. In recognition of her literary value, as you well know, these works received numerous prizes and awards. Her collection of short stories, Interpretive Maladies, for example, received the Pulitzer Prize in 2000. And later on, Lahiri devoted herself to creative writing, yet in another language, with a book in Italian that was published in 2015 and was titled In Altre Parole, in English, in other words, has been translated as well. Undoubtedly, the choices made by Lahiri, those who are engaging creatively with different languages and are reflecting various cultures, do not represent something unique and isolated and in the history of literature. Among the numerous other authors who adopted similar procedures in the past, one could cite such authors as Samuel Beckett or Vladimir Nabokov, Agatha Christie, all of whom wrote in more than one language. And then more recently, in Italy, because of increased mobility flows from other nations, one could mention the fertile production of first and second generation migrant writers. I'm just, you know, panning out and, you know, just to say this is not an isolated case. But if anything, one could presume that amidst the large community of authors straddling various languages and cultures, and at the same time falling between two or one more stools, paraphrasing one of Rushdie's ironic definitions of pluricultural writers, something that may differentiate them is the level of their linguistic and cultural proficiency. Some of them, in fact, learned more than one language in their childhood, while others began the process in later phases of their life. Additional traits that distinguish these writers, one from another, also result from their specific choices and their different cultural and political affiliations. So the present study on Lahiri intends to shed light on the singularity of methods within the common substratum that connects her to the community of pluricultural and plurilingual writers. It also wants to consider how and why Lahiri translates different diverse cultures in a work, in addition to examining how this work interacts with various literary canons, including national and transnational ones. Before proceeding to this analysis, however, it's worth defining some terms. For example, what is to be intended by literary canon? I mean, there are many definitions. I'm just, you know, I thought that Romano Luperini proposes a useful way of defining this term and distinguishes two connotations. According to the first connotation, a literary canon represents a group of works characterized by homogeneous rhetorical norms, taste, and poetics. These traits are generally accepted by the members of a community and are elaborated in their works, contributing to the development of an accepted tradition. According to the second connotation, the canon is instead determined on the basis of reception. It's formed through a choice of texts that are representative of the cultural identity of a community and reflects the dominant values in which that community believes. This choice of text is influenced by the globalization of cultural industry, the propensity to multi-ethnicity, and the formation of supranational entities. Luperini thus stresses the tension between the internal laws of a literary tradition accepted by a community, for example, the imagined community of the nation, I'm just quoting, you know, the famous expression by Benedict Anderson, and some external pressures that can lead to profound canonical transformations. I believe that Lahiri's work may be studied as a fragment prefiguring a broader picture. Originating from a creative elaboration of diverse culture, it may be conceived as an indicator of some developing trends that are modifying national and transnational literary canons. Lahiri's work itself, as a canon, may be considered from an internal and an external perspective. The internal perspective enables one to understand how Lahiri's work functions. For example, it helps to observe either the acceptance or rejection of previous literary models. It also favors an understanding of narrative dynamics and how diverse cultural memories and languages are mediated in the texts. Above all, it illustrates how different forms of cultural identity are represented and negotiated. The external perspective, instead, facilitates an examination of how Lahiri's work responds to new literary currents in rapport to the world of cultural production and fruition. It helps to contextualize the interpretative agreements and disagreements of the hermeneutic community, how this community accepts or rejects Lahiri's work in rapport with different types of canon, and why. The external perspective thus enables one to observe how Lahiri's work relates to the question of cultural hegemony, I'm borrowing a Gramscian term, and reveals how it responds to politics of social emancipation and inclusion. If one starts from the external perspective through a consideration of recent criticism of Lahiri's work, certain recurrent themes stand out. Most of the studies, for example, note that Lahiri's questioning of rigid national mainstream codes. I was just exploring different articles of books that have been studying on her, work. Some of them highlight the concept of border crossing, for example, or else when they refer to her characters, they speak about marginalized identities and immigrant experiences within a nation. Of course, some other works explore the relevance of translation, bilingualism, of methods that are necessary to facilitate communication and integration. Moreover, in referring to the author, certain works describe Lahiri as a minority writer, while others use different definitions. Diasporic writer, South Asian writer, American writer, transnational writer, postcolonial writer, and finally, postcolonial and then cosmopolitan writer. So through this recent scholarship, one might distinguish a variety of evaluative criteria and concerns regarding the maintenance or the overcoming of this kind of more restricted canon. In the United States, for example, most scholarship that notices and appreciates Lahiri's cosmopolitanism also favors the formation of transnational canons. The scholarship usually avoids mentioning a possible connection of the author with the group of multicultural minority writers. I'm sure here there will be people who have been conducting research on this topic even for longer, and I'll appreciate their comments. But probably this is due to the fact that in the United States, part of the criticism that is supporting multicultural minority writing favors a national political agenda. This criticism justifies its scarce emphasis on Lahiri's cosmopolitanism as that of other writers because it believes that this trait is often linked to a universalist idea that erodes diversity in terms of race, ethnicity, and other social traits within the nation. And those traits instead should be considered by criticism in order to fight discrimination and defend civil rights. Different scholarly works about Lahiri in the United States, I find that have recently attempted to overcome the conflict initiated by the rival critical interpretations that either favor her association with cosmopolitanism or go against it. And usually these scholarly works focus on Lahiri's fiction written in English. One of them, which seems particularly representative, is titled Minority Cosmopolitanism, and is written by Susan Koshy. Here, the critic, before analyzing Lahiri's Interpreter of Maladies and Unaccustomed Hearth, proposes to read the two literary texts through an analytical tool that she defines as a framework of, I'm quoting, minority cosmopolitanism, I'm quoting. In her opinion, this framework is essential to tracing a dual movement, centrifugal and centripetal. The centripetal movement reveals the most solid affiliations of race, ethnicity, and culture with minorities within the nation reflected in Lahiri's work. The centrifugal energy instead prompts the observation of, and I'm quoting, outward movements into other inventive affiliations, unquote, within a global context. According to Koshy, this framework reveals that Lahiri's works primarily carry, and again I'm quoting her, non-Western modes of cosmopolitanism and offer alternative visions of cross-cultural exchange and transnational affiliations, unquote. Moreover, together with similar works, these works contribute to the deconstruction, and I'm quoting again, Eurocentric genealogies of cosmopolitanism, unquote. So Koshy's observations invite one to speculate on the parallelisms among cultural elements that may be observed from an internal and an external perspective. In that, from an internal perspective, certain texts by such diasporic writers as Lahiri that translate elements from different cultures present minority and transnational elements, along with their interactions with national elements. Because of these traits, these texts lend themselves to various canonical alignments. They may be co-located either at the margins of a national canon or somewhere between the canon. The versatility, in fact, prompts reflection on what is to be conceived of as minority and mainstream literature, and also as national and transnational literature. It also induces one to ponder on how cultural authority and translation may affect one another. For example, how translation may challenge a dominant cultural authority that is based on rigid national priorities and a critical constructions of what is deemed as other. So to understand better how exchanges between the national and the transnational are represented while examining Lahiri's work from an internal perspective, it is worth referring to concrete textual examples. Here I'll be very synthetic for questions of time, and then we can expand on some points during our discussion. In most of Lahiri's works written in English, for example, these exchanges may be noticed through the making of various central persona. Through their characteristics and actions, these persona manifest an intersectional identity that relates to different cultures in terms of gender, ethnicity, and race. One could actually state that these persona embody translation in that they are constantly observed in their mediation of different languages and cultures. Using a metaphor, these persona function as bridges between specific cultural geographies, mostly South Asia and North America. Only to provide an example, in the story When Mr. Pizarda Came to Dine, collected in Interpretive Maladies, the main characters, a mother, a father, a daughter, and their guest, Mr. Pizarda, reveal diasporic traits and find themselves to change their positionality in the world because of new political and geographical configurations. In the short story, Mr. Pizarda is an international scholar from Dhaka, temporarily affiliated with the New England University in 1971, who is regularly invited for meals by family emigrated to the United States from South Asia. Through Pizarda's personal history, one becomes aware of national transformations in South Asia, linguistic translation between Bengali and English, and also cultural mediation between America and South Asia. Through Pizarda, one learns that before he went to the United States, he lived in Pakistan. However, because of a war in South Asia while he was in the United States, when he returned home, he found a new country. That was Bangladesh. So in fact, according to historical accounts, Bangladesh was partitioned from Pakistan in 1971, and Pakistan in turn was separated from India in 1947. So that for what concerns most of Lahiri's works written in English just for now. In my opinion, Lahiri's book, In Altre Parole, written in Italian and published in 2015, adds a new perspective to the discourse initiated by Cosci in her article about the reception of this contemporary woman writer. One may recall that Cosci had associated Lahiri's work in English with a strand of minority cosmopolitanism that rejected Western modes and Eurocentric genealogies. However, with the book In Altre Parole, Lahiri invites us to rethink that point. That was intriguing me because, I mean, you know, we have first a kind of classification in a certain way, and then we have this work that makes us rethink, okay? References to minorities and transnational exchanges do persist in that book in Italian. But cultural affiliations expand. In fact, in the book In Altre Parole, instead of English, Lahiri uses an idiom that is not native to her. I mean, she's a translingual writer here, even more than when she's writing in English. So she uses Italian. She writes an autobiographical story accompanied by sporadic fantastic parts that allude to adjusting to a new cultural environment, learning a new language, and being creative in a new place through a new learning experience. The female autobiographical subject, in fact, describes her impressions of Italy, a country that is new to her. As in a diary, she records the progress that she makes with the new language, even as she writes in it. For example, she admits that, in order to understand Italian culture more profoundly and to improve her mastering of Italian, she has diligently been studying Italian canonical literary texts. She states that in order to learn new sophisticated linguistic structures, she has been reading, and I'm quoting, slowly and conscientiously, unquote, some novels by Alberto Moravia and by Cesare Pavese, and some poems by Salvatore Quasimodo and Umberto Saba. So, thus, in this work, Lahiri focuses on the Italian language, as I said, and literary tradition. Yet she doesn't seem to prioritize ethnocentric parameters, from what I understand, not to betray an alliance with some cosmopolitan writers who didn't adopt Western models earlier. I find that the motivations of the choices seems rather to originate from a desire for promoting intercultural exchange, the celebration of pluralism, and also to put herself in a kind of defamiliarization that allows her to find new creative strategies and new ways of learning who she is by putting herself in a different experience that is new to her. So I think that in a way with this book, we are just invited to reflect on what it means to belong to an Eastern or Western canon. I mean, you know, we are just, you know, induced to rethink those kind of big categories that we use sometimes without questioning them. And she seems to propose an alternative route through which both definition and relation between the two categories and between national and transnational, familiar and unfamiliar, and I and the other, can be negotiated and eventually transformed in favor of a deeper communication. So just, you know, I conclude with this paragraph. Deepening then the discourse on reception, as noticed before, in the book In Altre Parole, Lahiri reveals of perceiving herself as an outsider in the Italian literary scene. And she says that in the book. This perception of being at the margins is something that probably Anthony Tamburi would define as a biculturalismo negato, a denied biculturalism. Yet, exactly with that Italian book, the writer gains access to a new market and entertains a dialogue with an Italophone public. In addition, thanks to Anne Goldstein's translation of the book into English the year after its publication in Italian, Lahiri proposes a different type of fiction to the Anglophone audience that was aware of her books in English, characterized by themes mainly regarding South Asia and America. So what Lahiri wrote both in English and Italian is the result of an original and versatile voice that quite rightly can be part of a variety of canons, from that of the South Asian diaspora to that of world literature. It is a work that, because of its value, reconfirms the expanding prominent role of women's writing and the voice of minorities. Okay, thank you.
I teach at Borough of Manhattan Community College, which is part of CUNY, and I teach in the English department. I teach Italian American literature, autobiography, and various writing programs, and right now I'm part of an effort to reform remediation at CUNY, so I'm involved with what goes on in our writing courses and writing pedagogy, and that's where I started working with translingual theory and how to present and enact translingual practice in the classroom with writing. But I decided to use that to look at Italian-American texts or Italian diaspora texts. What I see here is Italian diaspora studies is at the forefront of understanding identities in motion. In fact, human mobility, whether physical or virtual, is changing our uses and understanding of languages. These transnational contexts intersect with the paradigm shift in linguistics, which reflects our understanding of languages in motion. It is theorized as translingualism. And what I'm going to do is actually refer to many different writers like Ariel Dorfman and Gloria Anzaldu to explain translingualism rather than just tell you what it is. So it might seem a little confusing, why am I talking about these other writers? But I'll get to the Italian-American text and Jhumpa Lahiri. I will get to them later on. So while translingualism applies to the qualities and characteristics of many languages, the main focus has been on English, or we should say world Englishes. Translingualism provides a critical lens for understanding Italian diaspora texts. So what is translingualism? Ariel Dorfman's thoughts about the globalization of English can give us a good introduction. He calls it a, quote, mongrelization that inevitably comes when transnational people breed bodies and syllables. Dorfman recognizes how English is indeed transformed by its users in a continually flowing, dynamic process that contrasts its static, monolithic status, which characterizes a monolingual orientation. Reflecting on his own bilingual journey, he replaces the concept of the divided self with that of hybridized global identities. Quote, more and more people submitted to the obligation of dividing their brains between two or more linguistic systems end up unlinking language from the power of the nation and the coercion of the state, allowing other tormented bilinguals to feel accompanied in their own quests for the sort of pluralistic citizens that would constitute a model for tomorrow's new humanity. To understand Dorfman's observations, it's important to turn to his literacy autobiography, Heading South, Looking North. For he was tormented by his bicultural identity. He was born in Argentina, then exiled to the United States with his family, then exiled to Chile for his father's communism, and finally he resettled in the United States. Dorfman, quote, tried to escape the bifurcation of tongue and vocabulary as he decisively moved from Spanish to English, English to Spanish, from American to South American, because this was not just about language, but also identity. He attempts to resolve his dichotomy at one point by living in Chile, speaking Spanish but writing in English. But he could not resolve his tormented duality until he extricated himself from monolingualism. Quote, for me, resident of this dual existence, married to two tongues, inhabited by English and Spanish in equal measure, in love with them both, now that they have called a truce for my throat, the distress of being double and somewhat homeless is overshadowed by the glory of being hybrid and open. And if you're familiar with how Ariel Dorfman writes, they're very long sentences and you run out of breath before you could complete them. That's like half a sentence. Okay, so this idea of the glory of being hybrid and open, for Dorfman to accomplish that, he must disable his use of what I call divided worlds. Dorfman can disable the divided worlds motif because his experience belies his hybridity. For one, his movement across borders, however dichotomized as north and south, make him transnational. Indeed, Dorfman forces us to examine the artificiality of national borders, yet also how those borders become embedded in one's consciousness, which is something that Gloria Anzaldú also emphasizes. Anzaldú theorized the space between the borders, where a new mestiza consciousness is created, and that is useful for our understanding of translingualism. And I will talk more about Gloria Anzaldú later. Dorfman clearly illustrates the limits of monolingualism and its problematic enactment of separation and division. These limits and the final acceptance of his hybridity is something that we see in Italian-American texts, especially in autobiographical stories about one's use of language. We call those in English, in the field of English, literacy narratives. We use them all the time in English, in education as well, but that is an actual genre, the literacy narrative, where someone is writing about how they use language. Dorfman's book is called A Bilingual Journal. It's literally just about when he speaks Spanish and when he speaks English. So I would like to begin with one that we're all probably familiar with, Jerry Mangione's Mount Allegra. If you recall, in chapter 4, it's titled Talking American. And in this chapter, he presents the familiar divide between two cultures and two languages. My mother's insistence that we speak only in Italian at home drew a sharp line between our existence there and our life in the world outside. This binary is what Dorfman struggled with his whole life, and it's a feature of the monolingual orientation, which stems from Enlightenment ideas that rooted language and community in a single place. The idea that a community was associated with a language limited ownership of that language and territorialized language. This, of course, had questionable consequences. Translingual theorist Suresh Kanagaraja points out, quote, though efforts at language standardization, purification, and codification in many communities are often considered heroic efforts of progress, we have to also consider the ulterior motivations behind them. Kanagaraja's description reminds me of the gradual standardization of the Italian language in Italy, which became a mark of progress, a way of uniting city-states. The centuries-old regional dialects were suddenly devalued and negative stigmas developed. In the end, these dialects are disappearing. 31 of them are on UNESCO's endangered languages list. Similarly, Swahili, a language with Arabic and Bantu roots that was spread through trade, was chosen by British colonists as the standard language, subordinate to English, of course, in several African countries in order to better rule the area. And I also think of one other example, which is one of my students. I had a Nigerian student last semester who spoke three languages, English, Nigerian Pidgin English, and Yoruba, if I'm saying that correctly. And this student, because I have my students write about their languages and their different situations, and their literacy narratives. And this student reported in one of his writings that he was punished in his country for speaking Nigerian Pidgin English. It was so devalued that students were actually punished. They were fined. They had to pay money. So he had such a negative stigma with this language. And he said he tried to not use it. And I tried to explain, like from a translingual perspective, that that's who you are. That's part of your language. And it's okay to speak them. We value those languages and these languages are equal. So that's another effect of the monolingual orientation, is that when you standardize a language and you hierarchically position the languages, that's what happens to the dialects. They start to disappear. And they're internalized as so negative, and the student wants them to disappear. So with such examples in mind, we can no longer see monolingualism as separate from power colonization and imperialism. And the model is no longer adequate or accurate. Models based on fixed systems, grammatical competence, and homogeneous communities are not useful when we are dealing with plural languages and interlocutors. Unpredictability and diversity are the norm in postmodern globalization. I'm quoting from Kanagaraja. As Kanagaraja observes, languages are not hierarchically positioned, but relate to each other in fluid ways and become more hybrid in form. Translingualism captures languages as language as it evolves, created and recreated by user and receptors. In contrast to a monolingualist view of language as a fixed standard located outside of its users. Jerry Mangione understood translingualism, though he did not have that term to use. I'd like to read a little bit more from chapter 4. I just read that first sentence before, where he talks about his mother, you know, creating this division where they had to speak Italian at home and English was for outside. But then later on in the same chapter, this is what he says. After a little discussion with his relatives about the use of standard Italian and the different dialects and Sicilian, so they're all talking about that, sorry. And then he says, but if my relatives were under the impression that they were speaking the same dialect they brought with them from Sicily, they were mistaken. After a few years of hearing American, Yiddish, Polish, and Italian dialects other than their own, their language gathered words which no one in Sicily could possibly understand. The most amazing of these were garbled American words dressed up with Sicilian suffixes, strange concoctions. Oh, then he gives us some examples of them, right? So he said these come from a book that H.L. Mencken put together, The American Language. And you might remember, so actual examples were such words as minuto for minute, ponte for pound, storo for store, barra for bar, and jabba, I love jabba, for job. And then there was, of course, bacausa. Okay. I love this discussion. He said he saw the word bacausa in Mr. Mencken's collection of vocabulary, And he realized that that was a word that was in his relative's vocabulary as far back as he could remember. He realizes that my parents probably picked it up from other American Sicilians when they first arrived in Rochester. Certainly the word had no relation to their current mode of city life. It was used when referring to toilet and was obviously derived from the American backhouse that flourished in earlier and more rural America. Not until a few years ago, when I first visited Italy, a nation without backhouses, and mystified Sicilians there by using the word, did he realize that it was not an authentic word. So he says he was using it for his whole life, and he was always under the impression that that was an authentic Sicilian word. So that's just to give an example of what the mixing of languages is that is described in translingualism. It's what occurs to languages when they meet at the borders. While a monolingual orientation enforces strict separation, it's nearly impossible for languages not to impact each other. Mangione acknowledges standard Italian, but celebrates and values the dialects, which is part of the translingual project, which sees all languages as equal. More recently, Jhumpa Lahiri embarked on a translingual project with her autobiographical literacy narrative, In Other Words. I was so excited when I saw this book, knowing so much about translingualism, and I thought, wow, a more current example of translingualism. However, I was very disappointed when I read it. She defies, this is how I see it as translingual. It's a translingual project, because she's defying the monolingual orientation's restriction that a language can belong only to a specific community and express the thoughts and values of that community. She takes ownership of Italian, albeit standard Italian. As many of us familiar with her story know, she indulges in her love affair with the language by moving to Rome, immersing herself in Italian. We just heard about this. And later she struggles. But later she struggles much like Ariel Dorfman struggled. She feels like a divided person as she prepares to move to Rome and reads only in Italian while writing only in English to finish a novel. You see the similarities to Dorfman. While in Rome, she gains full immersion in the language and begins to write, speak, and think in Italian. English is abandoned. She never lets the two languages meet. Quote, reluctant to move back and forth between the two, she has her Italian translated into English so that the Italian text appears on the left and the English on the right. She explains, quote, my impulse at the time was to protect my Italian. This desire to keep languages pure and untouched by others is characteristic of the monolingual orientation, not translingualism. In fact, many of Lahiri's ideas about language reflect a monolingual orientation. Early in the narrative, she even writes, quote, every language belongs to a specific place, it can migrate, it can spread, but it's usually tied to a geographical territory, a country. These ideas began to dominate in the 18th century and led to some dangerous consequences, but for the past few decades, we've begun to question their validity as we acknowledge the fluidity of language varieties and witness their relationship with each other. Lahiri's project actually reveals the difficulty of shifting from a monolingual orientation to a translingual one, from national to transnational. She understands the space between the borders, for that's where she resides. Quote, I feel estranged now from the Anglophone writers I am linguistically related to, and I'm necessarily different from Italian writers. However, she cannot resolve this either-or, neither-nor binary, as Ariel Dorfman did, so that he could celebrate the glory of being hybrid and open. Gloria Anzaldúa's theory of mestiza consciousness provides a resolution and redirects our focus to the space between these worlds, the space where the hyphen or slash mark resides. From this position, we can interrogate the binary. A borderland exists as the liminal space between two borders, two cultures. Indeed, the borderland is a third world, quote, as Gloria Anzaldúa said, a vague and undetermined place created by the emotional residue of an unnatural boundary. It is in a constant state of transition. The borderland enables a more expansive consciousness that incorporates the multicultural, multilingual half and half. Anzaldúa's new mestiza consciousness help heal the divisions. For Italian-American women writers, this is my final example, the divided binary created painful conflicts and created the alienation and loneliness so well documented by Helen Barilini and captured by Tina DeRosa in her speech, The Passionate Woman. DeRosa's education left her feeling dislocated, and she calls it a gift and a burden. This is a common feeling among Italian-American women writers and working-class writers. However, for some, like M. Bella Mirabella and Mariana De Marco Tokornik, their education fosters stronger connections rather than divisions. As for Gloria Anzaldúa, her divided self empowers her with double perspectives that transform and create new identities, but also new ways of seeing. Angelucci employs the journey metaphor of crossing a bridge to symbolize how this new consciousness develops. It's actually a very common motif, the crossing of the bridge, and even Jhumpa Lahiri, she uses that when she's in Venice and she's talking about always crossing the bridge, and that's how she feels about language. But she's always talking about languages in terms of crossing and never about actually being, like I would say to her, being on that bridge. That's the space, you know, between the two. So this is back to Gloria Anzaldúa. The bridge, which is the boundary between the world you've just left and the one ahead, is both a barrier and point of transformation. So that's in terms of Gloria Anzaldúa. Jhumpa Lahiri sees it very differently. She sees it always as just a place you have to cross. Whereas Gloria Anzaldúa says, no, this is a barrier and a point of transformation. By crossing, you invite a turning point, initiate a change. Writing is essential to rebuilding the self and voicing this new identity. Anzaldúa explains that writing is an archetypal journey home to the self. Home is the bridge until there is a time when bridges are no longer needed. So as we see in these literacy narratives, the writers undergo a journey, usually through education, that transforms them. Their narratives capture this process, which sometimes involves a return home, a return in which their changed selves become apparent. Anzaldúa's process of gaining conocimiento, the consciousness, is comparable to the expansive awareness gained in higher education for those from the working class or immigrant families. For the new mestiza, Anzaldúa's autobiographical self, knowledge is transformative. She says, knowing is painful because after it happens, I can't stay in the same place and be comfortable. I am no longer the same person I was before. So finally, I just want to say, some Italian-American women writers transform their shame to pride through their education and return home with a greater understanding of their cultural origins. In many of these literacy narratives, the writers straddle the two worlds situated in the borderlands from which they gain a greater consciousness, and through their autobiographical writing begin the process of transforming others. Thank you.
So maybe this sort of comes off what Caroline was saying. I sort of thought that where you say that she's very binary about language in Italy, I thought she was using Italy as kind of a borderland between English and Bengali. She says that it's in terzo punto. Yeah. So I guess I don't read it as quite as binary, because I think she's using, I think when I read that, I see Italy as the borderlands between these two different cultures. So I don't know if you have any comments or thoughts on this, since
I did consider that when I was looking at the chapter, especially called The Triangle, but then I noticed the language in that chapter, the way she's describing the languages is like English is the foundation. It still was very structured, and they were not touching each other. That's what I was going by. They were not really, she never looks at languages as meeting and interacting. So maybe in some other thinking, you know, Italy serves as some kind of mediation between these cultures or identities, but it's the way she talks about it still in terms of the language is still, to me, monolingual. Not the monolingual orientation is a bad thing. You know, it's just a way of looking at languages. It's where we got to. It's what created. It's just when you read Suresh Kanagara's take on it, it's what led to colonialism and imperialism. And
which sounds
she's
like a kind of
like, don't forget about that. Like, it also did very good things, but, you know, created dictionaries, but it also had its problematic.
I was just thinking about. I think I started this project because it's a little bit of an autobiographical project, in the sense English is my second language, okay? So, and I was reading Jhumpa Lahiri, and I was thinking, how can you really separate the two languages all the time? I don't know if it's a reliable narrator there. No. Sometimes you can also write something that is not exactly what what it is, you know. It's just, if we think also the 20th century novels of Svevo, I was thinking about, you know, the La coscienza di Zeno. It starts, you know, with the doctor who says, you know, I don't know if you know about the doctor, but it just, you know, it puts you in this kind of state of the unreliable narrator. So we had to take that with a grain of salt, I think. And And I was thinking that I understand probably what I see there. There is this kind of ambition, a wanted to perfect the language as much as she can, because, I mean, you have a reputation already to keep. I mean, you are a person who received a Pulitzer Prize in English. And, you know, you, do you want to put out this kind of work with this kind of strange Italian out and just, you know, it's a big shame. And then there is the other chapter, I'm sure that you remember, you know, if both of you are interested in Jhumpa Lahiri. There is that chapter, is like l'impalcatura, I think, in Italian. It's like the scaffolding or the...
Scaffolding.
So, I mean, she admits that at some point she needed somebody who was a native speaker to give that kind of, you know, support and, I don't know, copy editing or something that was there. And that made me think also about the new writers in Italy. I mean, you know, this kind of generation of migrants who started, I mean, Immigrato, for example, with Salame Etnani, that was one of the first... works in Italy that was not just written only by this person, but also together with Fortunato, who was a journalist. So there was this kind of collaboration and writing in four hands rather than just, you know, the only person. So so I think, you know, I don't know how to, those are the ideas that triggered.
Well, I just want to say, what I do is look at various writers from various cultures that are writing these type of narratives, because it's not just Jhumpa Lahiri, because you could look at, I forget her first name, Mori, who wrote in, who was from Japan, but wrote in English. So you just get so many examples of this when they're writing about their own language, where they move to another, and write in another language. Yeah, but she's very self-conscious about it. Even just the fact that it's autobiographical, you know, she's indulging in this.
I think it's possible to distinguish between strategies of learning in which separation is actually a tactic just for maximizing exposure, and beliefs about how something will be used, or even about mental processes of comprehension. And I think in her book that she's actually often talking about a kind of strategy of comprehension and a strategy, you know, like an
immersion.
Yes. Full
immersion.
That's right. I know translanguaging, which you, is the term that I use, but in your term too, people who argue that a lot, and I know Suresh and other people do this, but, and I agree with them. I think there is a really liberating, emancipating message in what they say. There are many situations in the world where actually it's a very dangerous message. I mean, language revival movements are really hostile to this because it's just an invasion. They see it, and I think that it's not always the case, but it's not my place to tell them. And I actually think sometimes they're clearly right. It's a way in which all languages are imagined to be able to play in the same space, but some of them have enormous capital and power over others, and so in strategically it's possible to see environments in which separation is actually a very important process of allowing space for subordinated forms of expression to flourish and then to be more competitive, as it were, later on. So I just wanted to inject that because I think translanguaging, what was the term you used?
Translingualism.
Yeah, if these are aligned perfectly, I'm not really sure. I think there's a kind of message that comes with this often that's judgmental about separation, when I think there are many moments that I can see where separation is both ethically necessary for some kinds of groups and strategic for learners and other people. I'm not disagreeing with anything anyone said, I'm just kind of throwing that in.
One of the concerns with translingualism is that when you see languages side by side, and when you're looking at languages and how they truly and naturally interact, then you are bringing attention to the inequalities in language, and that's part of the project. So, like, even in our writing classrooms, part of it is to look at the symbolic associations of power with various languages. So it's kind of interrogating that and breaking that down. Especially when you look, even with English itself, you know, there's no one English and there are various dialects. And when you're in the academy, you have students that, especially where I teach at a community college, that don't have access to academic language and are using non-traditional forms, but that's, you know, that's what we call, you know, so, and they're not valued. So they're coming into the academy with languages that are not valued, and they have to learn the one. And right there, you know, we're just looking at that situation. So yeah, of course you're going, we're definitely still teaching academic language, but we're just teaching in a different way so that there's understanding of these other dialects and their role that they play. So it's just bringing them into the classroom as well, instead of keeping them outside, because that's just going to reinforce that hierarchy.
Hi, can I ask Sabina a question about Vita and Mazzucco? The quote, "since it's told, it's true," sort of strikes me as problematic. And I just want to ask you about Vita as teaching Vita in terms of how it works. When you were going over her research methods, and I come to this from the perspective of a historian, mm-hmm. thinking about teaching her in a history class, mm-hmm. And her research methods seem not just familiar to historian, but historical novelists of the proletarian fiction in the 1930s. One would combine research and memory and imagination and do what she did. This is how you would do it. So I was wondering what was sort of modern in this new literary twist in terms of her doing it. And then I was wondering how it teaches. Do our students sort of obsessed with what's real, what's not real, or can you recommend it?
I agree. I think I started thinking about what is real, what is not real, because of my, I guess, my personal story, and I started to become obsessed myself with archives, and I guess the fascination of the archive, and also myself, I found with very scant few records, and I said, what do I do with this? What is? It's really not much, and there is some kind of, I guess, the fascination of the, like, almost like an oracle, like tell me, I want to know, I want to find things, but. But there's also the awareness of, you know, the desire of having a little bit of freedom like she has done. So I'm not criticizing. I guess for me was more applying a little bit of awareness to what she has done, because I think it's quite intriguing. Yes, historical novels. I suppose that's what they are, and so it's not. I didn't find that unusual. I thought it was an interesting exercise to look at something so recent, and basically deconstruct it a little bit and see what she had done with more awareness
about these texts that she uses to do this research. So I've done just a tiny bit of research into, you know, ancestry.com kind of stuff. So I just don't know. And as you were talking, I was thinking, oh, that's really, that would be cool to look at those little records I have of ancestors or whatever and to write some story about it. So I was really inspired by this. But then I realized last week I got some notice that my DNA records had changed. They had done extra research. And instead of being, you know, all this Southern Italian, I'm like 14% French. And it's like, wow. So just saying, I'm not too sure what you do with these factual records, but it sort of changed every vision I had of what I was supposed to be. So
I actually didn't, I mean, for my own personal exercise, I didn't necessarily look at that, even though I have that as well. Okay. I guess I did more traditional things, like going to the parish or the historical archives in Siena. Yeah, that's where my family originally is from, and so that's basically what I've done, and trying to talk to the eldest family members, which in this case is my father, and and yeah, that's how I went. So it seems more reliable to me. Yes. Yes.
This is totally unrelated, but I was struck by something that Sabina said about Invita, that
there was some reference to the Mano Nero, and you refer to it as organized crime. But from my understanding from other similar historical novels like Elizabeth Street, and I want to ask this to the audience, wasn't it discovered that Mano Nero was not organized crime? It was just a series of copycats? And it was always portrayed as organized, but it was actually discovered to be random people who borrowed, because they
borrowed the symbol,
and just because it was in the news, and Joe Petrosino, who pursued the criminals at that time in New York City in 1920s, is featured in Elizabeth Street. So it's a novel, but it features the actual historical thing. But the Mano Nero is featured in, yeah. But that's where it comes out, that it was just, they later discovered it was just really copycats. I don't know if anybody
knows more.
Yeah, we don't use, yeah, from, that's my understanding, that you don't refer to it as, it was not, it would be a precursor to organized crime, but it was not organized in that way.
You mentioned the word mongrelization when you were talking.
Yeah. I think it was Ariel Dorfman.
Ariel Dorfman. Is that his term? Because it seems to fly in the face of the translingualism.
Well, I don't know. If you know his writing, he brings words from everywhere. Yeah, but that's...
Because it's not a celebrate. It's no glory in it. It's
yeah, but I think mixture. He's looking at the idea of mixture. I'd have to look at the, it's from an essay that he wrote, The Nomads of Language. That's where that comes, but, and from his literacy narrative. So, but you have to, I give him a lot of credit because of what his observations are saying is, you have transnational movement, and he's looking at what happens to language in this movement. And he realizes, and also the associations of power, because he's saying you have to delink it from the territories. So it's exact. He doesn't call it translingualism. He's not considered a translingual theorist, but if you read his work, that's what he's actually saying, exactly what translingual theorists say. So that's why I use him as a way of getting to the ideas.
Well, I had one question for Paola about, I've heard that Jhumpa Lahiri is thinking of translating herself, and I'm actually not sure if she means of like her English novels into Italian or vice versa. I think probably from English to Italian. Yeah, a friend of mine went recently to the festival in Ferrara, the international festival, okay. And she was present.
Yeah.
She was talking about this. And so I was wondering, you as a translator, I read that you also did translations. What do you think about this? Is it possible to translate yourself? Like, how hard is it in terms of... yes.
I think everything is possible. I mean, I've done it sometimes that, for example, you write an essay, you reintegrate that in a book. Maybe I wrote an essay in Italian, and then I extrapolated some ideas. Of course, quoting, I've been doing this, but,
Is it translation or rewriting, though?
Just rewriting, but, I think it really depends. But I speak about my experience, and I'm sure that there are different kinds of experiences, And I don't know exactly, I started learning English a little bit earlier than she did, okay. I learned with my first numbers when I was at elementary school, actually. And then I went into, as an undergraduate, I was double majoring in Italian, English, and French. So I cannot really identify myself completely with her, because she started when she was 27. Mm-hmm. And as you know, there are different ways of learning languages. If you put a child who is 4 years old in a room, he won't have an accent. People who are linguists here will tell me, but, I remember from my kind of, the little notions I had about linguistics, if up to a certain age, if you're just, speaking to a native speaker, you just pick up completely. I still have an accent, even if I can speak, I can be articulate, but I still have an accent. So I don't know exactly what her experience is, and also when she says I completely separate my English from my Italian, I don't know if that is always true. but from my experience, okay.
Yeah, so, probably, there's some like...
I don't know if also she has to create, you know, I mean, as I said, I mean, she's already a very well-known writer now. So I don't know if there is a pressure there to appear in a certain way in public spaces. Okay, that's what I was thinking.
Maybe it's to authenticate herself as an Italian. Maybe it was to authenticate herself as an Italian writer when because she's so proud of that moment where she can speak, think, and write in Italian. So maybe she's saying she's abandoning English because she wants to be recognized as an authentic, pure, you know, Italian speakers. Yeah. It's something about the way she's presenting herself.
Yeah, it goes back Italians to what you were talking about before as well, that, for example, migrant writers in Italy, they often have someone to, like, a native speaker to help them, you know, inverted commas, because there is the expectation that the language of literature is, like, of a certain level. But I don't know. I think it shouldn't necessarily be that way because it's. It would also be interesting to see other kind of literary language languages being published, and just give space to other what you referred to before, other like levels of other varieties dialects, between. Yeah. Yeah, I don't know if the dialects or not, but yeah, other varieties like within a language.
Also thinking, relating to what you were saying, it's also a question of privilege. I mean, you know, she is already goes to Italy with a certain privilege, yes. And there are other writers who just come to Italy. They even have to educate themselves, and they do not have the kind of support she has. So it's a different experience. I mean, the experience that Methnani or Cora, I mean, other you know early writers, Wendy Uba. I mean, you know, I'm thinking about some of those writers who write together with somebody else. I mean, it's certainly a very different experience from what Jhumpa Lahiri's experience is. Okay.
Yeah.
That's.
Well, I just want to say something. Translation figures in translingualism as the way that, as seeing the way that languages always act. You're always in a process of translation. So yes. That's one way it's figured.
Well,
of rewriting. And
yeah. Now, my question before, obviously, it is possible, but I would argue that it depends what kind of translator you are as well. But if you know what goes like your intention in writing the original text, then I would say it's really difficult for you to just stick to that original text and not be tempted to maybe rewrite certain parts, like with your like Italian brain or English brain. It's hard to. I would be curious to compare, you know, the two texts once they're done. Just yeah, I think it will be definitely a different product compared to a translation done by another person.